Time to worship. Oh, thanks, guys. please stand with us. It's your turn, okay, to get in the groove and worship. Man, this first one is just one that, well, it's going to get your blood going, so. I will sing forever of your love. Come down with my hands to heaven. Shout your praises loud.
I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love. Come down.
All right, good morning, everybody. Here we go. I once was blind.
I once was blind. I could not see. Chains of sin had shackled me. But God in heaven heard my plea. Jesus, Jesus, rescued me. Jesus, Jesus, rescued me. I will sing forever of your love. Come down with my hands to heaven. Shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love. Come down.
Na 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 na.
Now grace so sweet, it floods my soul, and hope eternal won't let go. My dead erased,
yes,
at Calvary. Jesus, Jesus, rescued me.
Yeah.
Jesus, Jesus, rescued me. I will sing forever of your love. Come down with my hands to heaven. Shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness till you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love. calm down.
Na 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 na.
Now there's a home beyond the sky. A song we'll sing for all of time. The grave is empty, I am free. Cause Jesus, Jesus rescued me.
Yes,
Jesus, Jesus rescued me. Now we'll sing forever of your love come down. With my hands to heaven, shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love come down.
I will sing forever of your love come down. With my hands to heaven, shout your praises loud.
I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love come down.
I will sing forever of your love come down.
I will sing forever of your love come down.
Na 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 na. Na 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 na.
Amen. Yes, he deserves some praise this morning. Man, good singing, everybody. You know what? We're just going to keep the joyful noise going this morning. So something like this. Kick it off for me. Doom, 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 doom. Doom, 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 doom. No piano. Do, 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 do.
Oh,
from heaven's throne. Let's see. From heaven's throne, you came to us and set your heart upon the cross. We'll never know the sacrifice you made for all our sin,
for all our sin and all our shame. You took the nails and took our place. No one else could do what you have done.
Here we go. One name.
One name is higher. One name is stronger than any grave, than any throne. Christ exalted over all. And from the grave where death would die, you rose again and brought us life. You're reigning now, the Savior.
This morning we're going to do that in praise as we've just done, in fellowship. We're also going to do that in prayer and in scripture. But be seated this morning as we go on with our service. So we just kind of lurk.
Good morning. What energy to start our service. Whoa, give them a hand. Hang on just a moment. I know I'm going to knock my brains out with that. Okay. And did anybody see any new faces up here? Yes. Praise God. Well, welcome to the Free Church this morning. We're delighted you are here to worship with us. If this is your first time, I seem to repeat this every time I'm up here, but I guess the other elders do as well. If anyone is here for the first time, or if there are those of you who have not visited the Connections table outside, please consider doing so this morning after church. I believe Cindy Cox is there this morning, and she can answer any questions you might have about our fellowship and about our church, and she can also get you signed up for our emails, weekly emails. Lots of information in those, especially about upcoming events. And occasionally, sadly, when we have to cancel an upcoming event due to the season we're in. Today, we deliver Thanksgiving food baskets. They will brighten the lives of some 45 families here in the community. And we are really thankful and pleased to be able to do that. In fact, let's bow for a moment of prayer for those families. Lord God, bless those who are the recipients of these baskets. May they see you and your grace through these provisions and come to know, Lord God, that you are the author of all good things. We pray in the name, Jesus' name. Amen. We do plan on scheduling a baptism, and the date has been established. It's the 13th of December. If anyone here is interested in pursuing baptism, please touch base with Rich or one of the elders, and Rich would be happy, especially, to talk with you about that. It was a very special time for those baptized last week. Was it last week? It was last week. And for all of us to witness their public expression of their trust and faith in the Lord Jesus as Savior. I chose for our invocation this morning Psalm 100. It's a psalm of thanks. I did it because in this season of COVID, we have Him to thank for loving us, for caring for us, and for walking with us through days of our struggles. I actually chose it for a different reason as well. I thought this was Thanksgiving week, but it didn't turn out to be Thanksgiving week. And once again, you forgive retired folks. Most of the time, my connection with calendars, be they on the wall or in my phone, very loose. Calendars and just don't make that much difference anymore for we who are blessed to have lived this long, right, Norm? The message of this psalm, Psalm 100, definitely trumps the calendar. Let's read it, 5 short verses, but so helpful in reorienting our thinking. Psalm 100, a psalm for giving thanks. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before Him with joyful songs. And we've done that this morning. Know that the Lord is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. For the Lord is good, and His love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Would you pray with me, please? Lord God, we are living through a time that really does test us. We look for good news, but there really isn't very much good news. It's easy to be discouraged. It seems like everybody is worried about something. Recently, the state of our nation. Will our livelihoods survive? Will the virus go away? And maybe most significantly, who will it take from us? The truth is, Lord God, that we often look in the wrong places for answers. So, Father, let us refocus our thoughts to where they need to be. We revisit this psalm and offer it up as a prayer to you. Let us shout for joy to you, Lord. Let us worship you with gladness. Let us come before you with joyful songs of praise. Let us remember you are Lord. You made us, and we are yours. So, Father, we enter your gates with thanksgiving, the gates of this church this morning, your courts with praise. We give thanks to you and praise your name, for you are good, and your love endures forever. Your faithfulness will continue through these difficult days and through all generations. Thank you, Lord God, for who you are, for loving us, for bringing peace into our lives, and allowing us the endurance to weather these days, which will be behind us at some point. We lift our prayers to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus. Amen.
Well, would you guys stand with us again? We have a special kind of service today. Preaching is going to be about communion, and we're going to celebrate that today. So, next couple of songs are going to speak into that, but also the greatness of our God.
Messiah,
Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel.
Why we come to church to just celebrate Him in that special way on this day and together. And I know we celebrate the Lord throughout the week, but Bob kind of talked about something that just, it's easy to see no hope, but there is hope, and that is because we serve a risen Savior. And as we sing this song right here, You Are God Alone, just watch those words. He is unchangeable, and He's going to be unshakable. He's unstoppable, and that's what He is. He's not created by human hands. He's not dependent on man. Let's sing. We're almost there, sorry. Here we go. You're not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plan. That's just the way it is. You are not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plan. That's just the way it is.
It's all about Him.
You are God alone. Before time began, you were on your throne, you were God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne, you are God alone. You're the only God whose power none can contend. You're the only God whose name and praise will never end. You're the only God who's worthy of everything we can give. You are God, and that's just the way it is.
I'll sing it out.
You are God alone. From before time began, you were on your throne, you are God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne, you are God alone.
Unchangeable,
unchangeable, unshakable, unstoppable, that's what you are. that you are unchangeable, unshakable, unstoppable. That's what you are.
Let's just think about that. Unchangeable, unshakable, unstoppable, that's what you are. Sing that again. Unchangeable, every time it's hard. Unshakable, when it looks bleak. Unstoppable, that's what you are. We serve a risen Savior, but you guys be seated today. Thank you.
Church. Good to see y'all. We're going to talk about communion today. We talked about baptism last week, but if y'all would just, I'm a little bit behind right now, so if you just forgive me, Norm Cooper, I need your help with something, bro. Norm, I've got this employment application for McDonald's, and I need a reference. And I think they're going to give me my notice any day, because Aaron did such a great job last Sunday. And I don't know if I'm going to have a job. Didn't Aaron do a great job last Sunday?
Amen.
He sure did. He is a blessing to our church. Tiffany, his beautiful bride, is a blessing to our church. Edmund, their son, is a blessing to our church. And as we talked about baptism last week, baptism is a blessing on our church. God is bringing new life into his church. And we all get to be a part of that. Isn't that cool? And we're going to talk a little bit more about that, okay, as we go forward. I do have one correction, though, for Aaron's sermon. You know, Aaron said that to be baptized is a command. And for us military guys, it's very easy to obey commands because we're in the military. That has nothing to do with the military. This has everything to do with the fact that I'm a happily married man. Get it? That was a joke. That's why it's so easy for me to follow commands, because I've got Donna over there to give them to me. And I'm happy to obey them. We're going to talk about communion. You all know that there are many accounts of communion. Can I get the next slide, please? And so to help me today, we have two of our ladies in the church who are actually going to read for us the scriptural references to communion. And so I'm going to be quiet and sit down for a minute, and they're going to come forward and read. And so follow along in your scripture if you care to. We're going to be reading through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and 1 Corinthians, which are the references to communion with which we are all familiar.
And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives.
Mark 14.
How are we doing?
Oh, just like that. Okay.
You just have to put it in your mouth.
Oh, okay. Okay. All right. Mark 14, 20 through 26. And as they were eating, he took bread and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, this is my body." And as he took a cup and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and they drank of it. And he said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly, I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives.
Luke 22, 14 through 20. When the hour had come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. Then he said to them, "With fervent desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took the cup and gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you."
1 Corinthians 11, 17 through 34. "But in the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and I believe it in part. For there must be factions among you in order for those who are genuine among you may be recognized. When you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper that you eat. For in eating, each one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry, another gets drunk. What, do you not have houses to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I commend you in this? No, I will not. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever, therefore, eats this bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, that so eat of this bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined, so that we may not be condemned along with the world. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If anyone is hungry, let him eat at home. And so when you come together, it will not be for judgment. About the other things, I give directions when I come."
May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Amen. Thank you, ladies. Appreciate that.
I don't know what to do with this. Oh, geez.
All right. Next slide, please. Communion. There's many names to communion, and many of you, we call it communion here in church. You've also heard it called the Lord's Supper. You might have heard it called the Eucharist. Am I a little loud? Do I seem a little loud to you? Can we go down just a little bit, please, Chad? Because it seems loud to me. And I'm loud enough, as my daughters have told me. Well, maybe that's too far. A little bit up, Chad, a little bit up. You'll figure it out. Eucharist comes from the Greek word. We have it up there, Eucharisteo. But all of these mean the same thing. So if you're more familiar with one name than another, that's okay. This is a time when we come together as a body of Christ to give thanks to the Lord.
And that's what we want to focus on as we move forward. The specific name isn't what's important. It's about what we're doing when we come together to share communion. Next slide. Well, where does this come from? We've heard these accounts, as the ladies read for us in the scriptures, about this celebration of giving thanks. And in Exodus chapter 12, this is where it all began. It began at the Passover. The Passover, which Jesus is commemorating with his 12 disciples up in the upper room at this time, the night before he is taken, betrayed, and will die on the cross. He's celebrating Passover. And what is Passover? And some of us might remember there's the story of these 10 plagues that occur in Egypt as God is calling the people of Israel out of Egypt and redeeming them. And that whole story about what happens is in Exodus chapter 12. And ever since then, in Leviticus, God, and we studied Leviticus last month and the month before that, God establishes this celebration. And the Israelites for the last 1,500 years at the time of Jesus, so for 1,500 years before him, they have been celebrating Passover, which looks back in thankful remembrance for the redemption of God that occurred through the sacrifice of the Passover lamb. What are they to do? They're to take a Passover lamb, kill it, and spread its blood up on the lintel, on the doorframe of their homes, so that the angel of death will pass over all of the homes of the Israelites, and the Israelite firstborn will not die. Well, Jesus is celebrating this. But remember, as we've said maybe too many times, Augustine said that the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed. That's what's been happening for 1,500 years. And the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. And so Jesus at this point will now open up Revelation as he comes forward to do the ministry to which he came to do in that first time that he came to earth. And from now on, instead of celebrating that act of God in the past of redemption, he's going to point us forward and say, from now on, when you come together and celebrate communion, that also will be a looking back in thankful remembrance for redemption by an act of God and God alone. But now that sacrifice will change, and it will be the Lamb of God. And for those of us who sit in this room, we know his name. His name is Jesus. Next slide. Okay, well, why do we need to do this? And interestingly enough, as we talked about baptism last week, baptism is a once and for all thing. You get baptized one time as a believer. Some of you maybe have baptized when you were children. Some of you may be coming forward to practice believer's baptism, which is what we do in the evangelical church, not just the free evangelical church of what we are a part, but all of the evangelical churches out there celebrate believer's baptism for the most part. Not every single one, but for the most part. We want you to come forward and experience that and pledge your loyalty to the Lord Jesus Christ. Right? It's a symbolic act, similar to marriage when we have baptism. And just like marriage is a public declaration, right? Norm, you're on Pam's team. And Pam, you're on Norm's team. And no one else gets to be on that little marriage team. And we do that for how long? I can't even get this thing off. It's so cold today. We have these rings that we wear, right? And they're circular. And they're circular to represent what? Forever, eternity, right? And that's what baptism is. You say, Lord Jesus Christ, I am on your team forever. And based upon that profession of faith, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But it's a one-time deal, just like marriage is supposed to be a one-time deal as well. Well, communion is different, though. We celebrate communion over and over and over again. There's repetition to communion. And so we have to scratch our heads a little bit and say, these are the two ordinances of the church that God has given to us. Why are we doing this one over and over and over again? And we see that Jesus, he gives us some information in the book of John in chapter 6. He'll say, I am the bread of life. Right? And he will also say, my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. And what we learn from this fact of communion is that we are to feed upon Christ. We are to daily rely upon Christ at regular intervals in our life. We celebrate communion over and over and over again so that we have that practice established where we are coming to the Lord Jesus together. And we are sharing in this over and over and over again to teach us that, yes, we must rely upon him each and every day. Next slide. It also teaches us that we're to have fellowship with Christ. Koinonia. You've heard that word if you've been around church for a while. And we normally translate that to fellowship. But in 1 Corinthians, when we have some of the Holy Spirit's speaking into this subject through the pen of Paul, we hear that the cup of blessing which we bless, is it not a participation, a koinonia in the blood of Christ? And also the bread which we break, is it not a participation in the koinonia in the body of Christ? And fellowship, for any of y'all Southern Baptist background, I know we got a couple Southern Baptists, you know, that just means a potluck, right? That's what fellowship means. Let's have a potluck, right? And I loved that, you know. Every time we had a church meeting, there was always food involved. And some of us, Dick smiling, hey, he's going, yeah, that sounds good to me too, Rich. Right? But this is actually a meal that we celebrate together, is it not? And so, yes, that whole idea of having some food and breaking bread together, yes, that's part of what we're talking about. But in this case, what we're really hearing is that we're to have spiritual intimacy with the Lord Jesus Christ. When we come together as a body of Christ to celebrate communion, there's also an aspect of this that has to do with spiritual intimacy. And this is more prevalent when we look and see the prayer that we offer at the end of communion. When we as a body of Christ come together to celebrate what he's done in our life and in the life of our church. Next slide. Another aspect is it's a pledge of loyalty. Also in 1 Corinthians, we'll hear, you cannot drink of the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake at the table of the Lord and the table of demons. You have to choose. But when we come together as a body of Christ, what we're affirming is that, yes, Lord, we are on your team. Baptism is when you say, I am on your team, Lord. It's a pledge of loyalty. We wear symbols of loyalty and commitment. But when we come together as communion, that also is how we corporately say, Lord, we are on your team. And we're on that team for forever. Next slide. It also speaks to the unity of the Christian people. Again, in Corinthians, and we're getting a lot in 1 Corinthians 10, and so I'd encourage you to continue to read through that chapter before 1 Corinthians 11. 1 Corinthians 11 is the one we normally talk about when we talk about communion, and Christy read that for us today. But it says in chapter 10, because there's one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. And in chapter 11, it will say, anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord, well, it's not the body on a cross, it's the body of the Lord, the body of Christ. It's the community of a local church. And so we do this together. If we listened up to what Christy read for us, it says, hey, some of you do this too quickly. You need to wait until all of you are gathered together. An ecclesia, a gathering, a church. And that's why we do this together. We take the bread and we eat it together, and we drink the wine together to express unity, which is the one thing, pretty much the main thing. I won't use the absolute of the one thing, but it's the main thing that Jesus prayed for on the night before he went forward to the cross. And we see this in John chapter 17, the high priestly prayer. And he says, Lord, let them be one as you and I are one. And he speaks to the unity of the church. Next slide. All right. So those are some of the aspects. Let's look at the practice of the first century church. And we hear in Acts chapter 2, very close to the birthday of the church, when Peter preaches that one sermon, they say, Lord, what must we do? As Aaron helped us understand, repent and be baptized. And 3,000 were added to their number on the very first day. And what did they do after the birthday of the church? They devote themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, koinonia, to the breaking of bread and to the prayers. And we see that this becomes a regular practice. Later on in the book of Acts, in Acts chapter 20, we hear that one of the churches that has been established at Troas, on the first day of the week, they gather together to break bread. This becomes the regular practice of the church. When they come together to worship, they celebrate communion at some point in that worship service. Next slide. The Didache, a book that when we translate it, it's the teachings of the 12 apostles. Well, what is the Didache? And it's a Greek document. It's dated to about 50 to 150 AD, which that's pretty good. So it's a first century document that was discovered in 1873 by a monk in Constantinople, in what we now call Istanbul, which was one of the centers of the early church. And he found this document, and it's not a very contested document. It's not, everyone pretty much sees this as a valid document. And it's kind of the first church manual. It's kind of the how we do stuff in the first century church. And the Didache addresses things like baptism, but it also addresses things like communion. And one of the quotes is, on the Lord's day we gathered together and we are to break bread and give thanks, having first confessed your sins so that your sacrifice may be pure. This is not the inspired word of God. I want to make sure I say that. This is an extra-biblical document, but it helps us be more informed about the practices of the first century church. These are what the apostles would have taught to the church. And we now see that this corroborates what we hear in scriptures. In Acts chapter 20, it said they gather on the first day to break bread and have communion. And here we see in the practices of the early church, this is what was established in their church manual, in their How to Do Church book. Next slide. All right, let's open up our Bibles to 1 Corinthians 11, 27 through 29. I want to go back into that. I want to explain that. I usually read that at the first part of communion. And so I just want to unpack that a little bit. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, in verse 27, in 1 Corinthians 12, oh, sorry, that's a typo. No, go back one, you're in the same spot. Go back. So that's 1 Corinthians 12, I apologize. That's a typo up there. 1 Corinthians 12, chapter 12, verse 27, it says, whoever therefore eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment upon himself. So what does this mean? Part of this is that if you're not a member of a gospel-preaching church, if you're not a committed Christian or a believer or someone who's come to a saving faith in God, you shouldn't take of communion. You should refrain, because communion is an act for believers, for people who have sworn their allegiance to the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you're not there yet, well, that's okay. But what we don't want you to do is to participate in something that is not going to be helpful for you. The other issue is, if you are a believer, this is leaning more towards the fact of coming to the table with an unconfessed sin. If you haven't dealt with a rupture of relationship, sin is something that separates us from God. But when we sin against someone else, it also separates us from them. I've told a story in some of our small groups or our Bible studies about how I had to apologize to Donna and my three daughters last week because I'd done something that was wrong. And so there was a little rupture in the relationship, a rupture in the relationship. How do we fix that? Well, we have this thing called reconciliation, Matthew chapter 18, right? We're to go and apologize if someone has sinned against his brother. You're to go to that brother or sister and speak to them about that, and hopefully you will win them over. They'll recognize their fault, and they will apologize. And that's what I got the opportunity to do. Hey, any of you husbands ever had the opportunity to apologize to your wives? No, Bob Nagy, never? Okay, well. I love Bob, isn't he great? Thank you, Bob, for being my student. Okay, so if you have something against your brother, what does it say? It says to leave your sacrifice at the altar and go deal with your brother. Because right now there's something in between you. And again, this is an expression of unity, that we are all together at this point. And so it's very important to do that. And I would encourage you to do that, because to not do that is to disregard its true meaning. And it's also to forget the price of our salvation. If you've got some grudge that you're holding against your brother or sister in Christ, or maybe your actual brother and sister, right? We need to resolve that and be reconciled so that we can all participate in this together. We can all come together and celebrate what the Lord has done in each of us and in our church. And if you don't do that, this can become a dead ritual. In fact, one of our members has come to me and he said, Rich, I haven't resolved this thing with this other person. And every single time I take communion, Rich, it's like dirt in my mouth. It's like ashes in my mouth. Yes, that's what's going to happen. The Holy Spirit is weighing on his heart. And what the Spirit is saying is, go and do what needs to be done. Rectify what is between you and your brother. And he says, Rich, what should I do? Well, I tell him, if you have an issue, you should let communion pass you by. There's nothing wrong with that. I've done that. In the last year, Donna and I were in a church, and there was an issue going on in the church, and we did not feel comfortable taking communion and participating in that. And so we just let it pass us by. Unfortunately, I like to sit in the front of the church. I'm normally the Coopers, and because I sing really loud. And we didn't know this, but everybody behind us stood up to take communion, and we were sitting down. We didn't mean to make this a big public declaration, but that's what it was. It was really embarrassing. So just be careful. If we're taking communion, everybody stands up. Just stand up so that, you know, and just let it pass you by. And that's okay. That's the normative practice, because the Lord commands us that we are to go deal with this rupture of relationship with our brother. Next slide. Okay, let's look at the actual words that Jesus spoke, or that we find recorded in 1 Corinthians 11. No, it was 11. It wasn't a typo. Ah, sorry, guys and gals. It's this big fat Bible that I use up here. I only use this Bible to preach from because it's the giant print, and then I can see it, and I don't have to borrow Susan's glasses. So I apologize. It was correct, and it is 11. But we're going to look in there. We're going to look at all of the words that are talked about, and we're going to see that there's deeper meaning. There's much more than just this kind of, hey, let's take a little wafer and a little bit of juice together. And so we'll unpack that. On the top of the slides that are coming, it's all in italics, meaning these are found in Scripture. But because they're found in multiple Scriptures, I don't give you all of the references each and every time, okay? But all of them pretty much agree with, in the beginning, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, and he broke it. And interestingly enough, this is also what happens when Jesus feeds the 5,000, that miracle where there's 5,000 people, they take five loaves, two fishes, and they feed
a multitude of people. And the 4,000, this miracle is repeated by Jesus. And interestingly enough, this is the only miracle during Jesus' ministry. So in the time before he goes to the cross, this is the only miracle that's in all four Gospels. And again, that just, when I see that type of thing happen, that perks up my spiritual antenna a little bit and says, pay attention here, Rich. This is something important going on. And so we see that. And as Jesus feeds the multitudes, right after that, they come back to him and ask for more bread. And he gives what's called the Bread of Life Discourse. So it's one of the very first sermons that we see, and these are all recorded. These sermons, these discourses, they're all in the Gospel of John. And in the Bread of Life Discourse, or sermon, he says, hey, folks, you need life. You don't need bread. You don't need food. What you need is life, and life is a gift, right? The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And he says to them, food only sustains life, mortal life. I'm here to do something radically different. I'm here to give you eternal life. We see this also in John chapter 4, right? The woman at the well, and Jesus says to her, you need something totally different than the water that you bring out of this well each and every day. You need something that's going to last for eternity. Wow. All of that when we recite, Jesus took bread and gave thanks and he broke it. Next slide. And then he says, this is my body, which is for you. That seems a pretty simple sentence as well, but this has got a lot of theological meaning packed in there. Jesus is going to go as our substitute to the cross to pay the penalty for our sin. And he does that so that we might have eternal life. This, in theological terms, is called substitutionary atonement. It's a big fancy word, but it's an important word. Because if Jesus doesn't go as our substitute, well, things don't go well. And he incurs the wrath of God, the infinite wrath of God on the cross. That's the cost. That's the penalty. It is a penalty that no one can pay, and only the Son of God can. And so when he says, this is my body which is given for you, he's talking about the act of love that transforms the world. We also read about this in the Old Testament. Again, the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed. This is in the book of Isaiah. And I put some references for you if later on you want to go learn a little bit more about this. But this was prophesied from old. The suffering servant, the Messiah, will come and do this. And we also see this in other parts of the New Testament as well, in Romans and also in 2 Corinthians and in Galatians. And so, yes, this is not something new. God always knew that this was going to be how he would reconcile lost mankind. Wow, that's a lot more in that sentence. Next slide. Do this in remembrance of me. And interestingly enough, this command is only found in Luke and also in the 1 Corinthians account. It's not in Matthew and Mark. And as I was studying through this, the commentator said, well, the breaking of bread was a normal ritual. It was something they were already doing. We saw that in the Didache. We saw that in Acts chapter 20. This was normal to be breaking bread and to doing this ritual. And so the thought is that Matthew and Mark didn't even think it was necessary to put that in. So it's not a difference or a rupture between the different gospel accounts. It's just the individuality of the authors of each. Next slide. And in the same way, he took the cup. And this is really interesting because we're talking about the cups of Passover. And in Exodus chapter 6, let's open our Bibles to Exodus chapter 6. Again, Jesus is celebrating the Passover. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. And there are four cups in Passover. And I brought something to help you understand this a little bit better. This is the only thing I have from my mother. So as many of you know, I was born and raised in a practicing Jewish home. And the only thing I have from my early childhood is these cups. And these are, they're all in plastic right now, and hopefully they won't fall. But these are the silver cups of Passover that my family never used. My mom would never take them out of the plastic. But every Passover, there are four cups that are drank during that. And so it's interesting to see which cup did the Lord Jesus bring. By the way, don't take those, okay? You leave those there. Everybody's been going, what's that old broken up box? Well, it has something pretty precious to me. So there's these cups that occur. And in Exodus chapter 6 in verses 6 through 8, let's read that and we'll find out what these cups are all about. Okay, Exodus 6, I'm in the right one. So say therefore to the people of Israel, I am the Lord, I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. That's the first cup. And I will deliver you from slavery to them. That's the second cup. And I will redeem you out with an outstretched arm, with great acts of judgment. That's the third cup. And I will take you to be my people, and I will be your God. And you shall know that I am the Lord your God, who brought you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. I will bring you into the land that I swore to give to Abraham, Isaac, and to Jacob. I will give it to you for a possession. I am the Lord. A statement of authority. And so when we celebrate Passover, the Jewish faith will take these cups at different times during the meal, and they will go back to those promises that sound a lot like the promises that we have in Jesus. In fact, these promises are very much like what we would call the New Covenant. And we'll talk about that in just a moment. Which cup did Jesus take during this Passover celebration and say, in the same way he took the cup? Tradition believes it's the third cup. It's the cup that is taken after the meal. And because Scripture says, after they had eaten, or in John chapter 13, which we didn't read, it doesn't have all of these words, we see that this is probably the cup that he took. And interestingly enough, the cup that Jesus says is the one by which we are to remember him is what the Jewish faith will call the cup of redemption. And that cup of praise, I will take you as my people, that is something that's going to happen in the future. And so we see that that is most likely the cup that the Lord refers to. And he says, and I will not drink of this cup until I am with you in heaven. That fourth cup Jesus never takes up. Fascinating, at least for this geeky little Bible student. Next slide. This is my blood of the covenant, the new covenant. And we know that the old covenant was something that was spoken about before. And Moses took the blood and he threw it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all of these words. And that covenant, that old covenant, is if you obey me, I will bless you. And if you disobey me, I will curse you. And of course, none of us are obedient. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And that's not just in the book of Romans. That's also throughout the Psalms. That's also throughout the Old Testament. Solomon himself recognizes no one is righteous. But what Jesus is doing when he says these simple words, this is my blood of the covenant, of the new covenant, he is linking in this practice of communion to what is prophesied in the book of Jeremiah and elsewhere in the Old Testament, to what we now call the new covenant. God will do what no man or woman can. And that will come as the promise of the new covenant, where he will take us
as his people. Well, he will write his laws upon our hearts, and he will be our God, and we will be his people. Next slide. Poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. This also is theologically packed. There's a lot going on in these simple statements. We know from the book of Hebrews, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness for sin. But communion is being connected to substitutionary atonement when Jesus says this. In Isaiah, again, that suffering servant passage of the Old Testament, it says, because he poured out his soul unto death and was numbered amongst the transgressors, all of these things occur. So even in the book of Isaiah, he's looking forward to what Jesus will do during his first coming, during his first earthly ministry here on earth. And so when we hear that as well, we have to remember each and every time what he's talking about is his sacrifice as our substitute on the cross. Next slide. And then later on in Corinthians, it says, for as often as you eat of the bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Passover, this celebration, it's called the Haggadah. And that word Haggadah means legend or parable or tale. For 1,500 years, the Israelites have been telling the tale of God redeeming them from Egypt. Over and over, that's what the Passover celebration is. It's this telling of a story about the great things that God has done. And Jesus says, through the pen of Paul in 1 Corinthians, yes, you are to continue to do that. You're to laud or to celebrate, proclaim. The word is katangelo. Aaron had to help me with that. So did Donna. They're like, dude, you said that all wrong. It's katangelo. We're to laud and celebrate each and every time we come together and take communion. We as a body of Christ tell again the tale. What has Jesus done for me? And what has Jesus done for us? Next slide. Communion, in summary, is a privilege that the Lord has given to his people, to a corporate body. It's to teach us to rely upon him. It's to teach us to have spiritual intimacy, to be in his presence and be with him consciously. It's also a statement of loyalty. We're to be loyal to him and remain in relationship for forever. And we're to stand united with him. There's to be nothing that separates us from our brother or sister in Christ. We are to come together and stay together no matter what. Just like in marriage, we're to stay together no matter what. Next slide. So we're going to celebrate communion. And if the worship team will come back up, we're going to listen to one of their wonderful songs, a little different song, before we take communion. But when we do that today, I would encourage you to think about what has the Lord done for you in your life and also in the life of his church. We see new life in this church. We have people being baptized. We have people joining the church. I know four families right now that want to come join our church in formal membership. We have four ladies that are about to give birth in the spring to actual babies in our church. I kid you not, he is bringing life here. We should be thanking the Lord for what he does in his midst. We're to be thoughtful for the gift of brothers and sisters in Christ. And we're to think, just like Augustine, what's coming next? We are to be thankful for what the Lord will do when he comes again in glory. When he comes as our King. And we all are with him and God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit. Let's listen to this song.
You know, we have the words up there on the screen. We're going to teach this today, but it goes so well with what Rich just presented. As you catch on, feel free to sing. Otherwise, you know, if you just need some time to pray and, you know, get close to God for a few minutes right before we go into communion, that's kind of what this is for.
Say, take this bread, take this wine, now the simple made divine, for any to receive. By your mercy we come to your table, by your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember you, and remembrance leads us to worship, and as we worship you, our worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation. We remember you. See his body, his blood, know that he has overcome every trial we will face. And none too lost to be saved, none too broken or ashamed, all are welcome in this place. By your mercy we come to your table, by your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember you, and remembrance leads us to worship, and as we worship you, our worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation. We remember you. Dying, you restored our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Lord Jesus, come in glory.
By your mercy we come to your table, by your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember you, and remembrance leads us to worship, and as we worship, worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation. We respond to your invitation. We remember you. Lord, we respond to your invitation. We remember you.
If the deacons will come forward and pass out our communion elements, we will open our Bibles to 1 Corinthians 11. And it says there, whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment upon himself. And so take a moment and if you have something that you need to do with the Lord, maybe there's forgiveness to be asked. Maybe there's something you need to deal with. Do so as we receive our elements. Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This is the cup of my blood, the new covenant." And if you can get this open, there's Donna when I need her. And he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we come before you. We thank you for the gift of communion. We thank you for the gift of baptism, where we can come and publicly declare, "You are our Savior and our Lord." We thank you for the gift of communion, where we can celebrate this great truth and this great reality, Lord, that we are now, through your sacrifice on the cross, able to come into the presence and communion with the Lord God our Father, and with you, Lord God the Son, and with you, Lord God the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. And we celebrate that as a body of Christ. We celebrate the gift not only of relationship with you, but the relationship we have one with the other as we corporately express this during this time. And we wait in joyful hope for your coming again. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hey, would you stand with us as we close? We're just going to sing that little pre-chorus and chorus as we end. And by your mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember you, and remembrance leads us to worship. And as we worship you, our worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation. We respond to your invitation. We remember you. Amen. You all just have a very blessed Sunday.